we gather in the name of the Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer. Amen. Let us join together in our call to worship this morning. In mystery and grandeur,
we encounter the God of all creation.
In renewed justice and the promise of new life,
we know the deep love of Christ.
In the wonderful diversity in every community,
the Spirit of God moves among us.
Let us worship the God of beauty, love, and wisdom.
We will praise God ever three and ever one, now and always.
Let us join together in our opening hymn, number 433, All Creatures of Our God and King. Welcome to worship on this Community Connection Sunday here at Knox Waterloo. To all those who are joining on live stream, listening on radio, or watching later on YouTube, we are so glad that you are part of this community. Today we welcome two leaders from a partner community organization, Faith Climate Justice Waterloo Region. Becky Voll, who will be leading, remotely leading the Fun with the Young Church time, and Henriette Thompson, who is here with us in the sanctuary this morning, who will be preaching. We are so glad that they are with us here this morning, sharing their passions and wisdom and teaching us how to be stewards of God's creation. Faith Climate Justice is a growing collective of faith communities in the Waterloo region advocating for climate action and a just recovery from COVID-19 pandemic. They work ecumenically and also encourage interfaith connections to discern how to step up our commitment to climate justice. We acknowledge that Knox Waterloo is located on the traditional territory of the Anishinaabe and Haudenosaunee and Neutral Peoples. Our building is situated on the Haldimand Tract, the land granted to the Six Nations that includes 6 miles on each side of the Grand River. We seek a renewed relationship with our neighbors, one that is based on honor and deep respect. We give thanks for the ability to gather, worship, and work together here. We cannot change the past, but we continue to share in the work of healing and reconciliation, respectfully following the leadership of Indigenous communities and leaders. Let us continue in prayer. Creator, Christ, and Spirit, you are the maker of a better world. You are the creator of lasting peace. We worship you for the gifts of peace and healing that you bring into our troubled lives. You have shown us the way to work for justice, to love friend and enemy alike, to build a better world. In this time of worship, inspire us to believe our work in your name makes a difference, so that we live to bring glory to you through our commitment to you and the communion we share with all your creatures. Open our eyes that we see the abundance of your creative love in all that surrounds and sustains us. Enable us to become people of hope and life who plant the seeds of your earthly garden for the benefit of all. Help us to be gardeners and caregivers for Mother Earth that is home for all life. Fill us with your gentle love that we may walk tenderly on the earth, cooperating with your intention of abundant love and life. God of grace and unity, we confess that we can be divisive when you have called us to unity, quarrelsome when you call us to seek peace, and critical rather than caring. We have grown used to our own ways and cannot imagine you would ask us to change even for the sake of the gospel. Forgive us when we mistake our familiar traditions for your truth. Show us how we can witness to your love through working and worshiping together. May we join together singing the prayer Jesus taught us now. Siblings in Christ, hear the good news. God's mercy is deeper than the depths of the sea, and God's grace is bigger than the whole earth. Let us be comforted by God's love that covers creation like a blanket and brings peace like a rushing river. Thanks be to God.
Hello, I'm so happy to be here. My name is Becky, and I'm part of a local climate group called Faith Climate Justice. What I love about this group is it combines two of my favorite things, God and the environment. Right now, today, I would like to talk to you about how we can love God, love our neighbor, and love creation. When Jesus was asked, what's the most important thing? What's the most important type of commandment to do? Someone asked him, teacher, what's the greatest commandment in the law? And Jesus replied, love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And second, it is love your neighbor as yourself. Now we can love God by taking care of what he has given us. God gave us the world to live in, and by taking care of our world, we are showing our love to God. So let's imagine this in a story, in an example. Let's imagine that I have a special gift to give. Now it's a gift that could break, a teddy bear, for example. So let's imagine I give someone the gift of a teddy bear. Now, so the person I give it to, let's say they draw all over its face, pull out some of the stuffing, and twist the eyes until they fall off. The person I gave this to may have enjoyed doing these things very much, and the destruction of this toy could have given them great joy. But as the gift giver, I would feel something. How would you feel if you were me? I would feel potentially disrespected, unappreciated, sad. My hope for the gift would be that it would be enjoyed and thought of as precious. God gives us gifts. God gave us the world, and he didn't just give it to us. He also told us to be stewards of it. Now, this means that God made the world and told humans to take care of it. God said that the world was good. For example, in Genesis, God looked on all that he had made, and indeed, it was very good. And God loves his world. In John, it says, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that everyone who believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. So when someone you love gives you something special to take care of, what do you do? Let's imagine that. Let's imagine an example where someone you love is going away for the weekend, and they ask you to take care of their very favorite pet. What do you do? Would you feed the pet? Would you care for that pet and make sure that it's healthy for the owners to return? I imagine that we would all want to do a good job of caring for something special that belongs to a person that we love. In the same way, we can take care of God's earth. God loves me. God loves you. And God gave us the earth to live on and care for it. Lord God, he took man and put them in the Garden of Eden, for example, in Genesis. And he said to work it and take care of it. I want to please my living, loving God. And I want to treat his gifts to me with respect and care. So what are some ways that we can take care of our world? Being good to nature is one way. And that can even look like using less and producing less garbage. If we make too much garbage, we could have a mess on the earth, right? And when we use less, we're taking better care of the earth. This allows the earth to stay clean and filled with the plants and animals that God made. Now, if you remember, Jesus didn't just say one thing. Now, loving God is very most important. Number two, we should love our neighbors as ourselves. Okay, so who are our neighbors? Well, everyone, the people living in this whole world with us right now, and the people that will live on this earth when we're gone. Now, did you know that the garbage that we make here in Canada sometimes gets sent to other countries? Here's an example. This is someone's backyard. So when we ship our garbage out to other countries, it can make other people's backyards very polluted. Now, there's a lot of environmental issues today that are affecting humans. And we are all connected in this world and share the same earth. People in this world are suffering because of our personal choices. Sometimes it's from the things that we buy and the lifestyle choices that we make here in Canada. Now we can love our neighbor by taking care of the environment. One way is to help is to make less garbage. Sometimes this looks like making choices. For example, picking a snack with less packaging. When we produce less garbage, we don't send so much trash into nature in our own country or to other countries. This means we are polluting the land less, and more people can live in a clean place filled with the beautiful nature that God has made. Caring for the environment is acting loving towards our neighbors. Remember, neighbors means other people. So we're being loving to neighbors that we have in the world right now and the neighbors that will live in our world in the future after us. Let's talk about some of the things that you can do to love creation and therefore loving God and loving our neighbors. We can pick up litter and put it in the right place, the garbage. We can recycle properly by separating our plastics and cleaning them, and also putting our food waste into a compost bin. We can make different choices about the food that we're eating and what it's packaged in, for example. We can use reusable lunch containers. And instead of using a disposable water bottle, we can drink water from the tap and put it into a reusable water bottle or a glass. And we could also stop using plastic straws and use paper ones if we want to substitute. Another way to act loving for the environment is to plant a seed or a tree. Another example could be with the toys you have, where you use rechargeable batteries in your toys and game controllers. Now, many of these choices are tricky, especially as a kid, because you don't always get to do the family shopping. But kids, you can help remind your parents to love God's creation. You can talk about different choices you make together. And if any of you are wondering what to do, there are many environmentally friendly solutions on the internet, or you could talk with other members of your church about what they are doing to love creation. There's also groups that you can reach out to for ideas, like the group that I belong to, Faith Climate Justice. So if you or your family ever needs help getting practical ideas to love creation, I would be happy to help you. Thank you so much for listening.
The musical reflection this morning includes some Maori words from New Zealand, so I thought I'd just translate them for you so you know the meaning of them. One phrase you'll hear is Wairua Tabu, which means spirit or soul. And another one is Aotearoa, which means land of the long white cloud. I thought that was such a beautiful image. This is called Come to Our Land. Come to our land, come to our hearts, spirit of peace, spirit of truth, bring in the spring, the hope and the green, spirit of growth and spirit of youth, and all our people will sing together, Wairua Tabu, holy your name, there's one great spirit in all creation, one great spirit of God. Come to our land, come to our hearts, spirit of life, breath of new birth, teach us to care for water and air, nourish the seed and cherish the Spirit of God. Come to our land, come to our hearts, spirit of bush, spirit of bird, speak to the soul of Aotearoa, joy in your world and joy in your word, and all our people will sing to one great spirit in all creation, one great spirit of God.
The McLean family will be reading our scripture reading today about the Samaritan woman and Jesus at the well from John 4, verses 1 to 42.
Jesus realized that the Pharisees were keeping count of the baptisms that he and John performed, although the disciples, not Jesus, did the actual baptizing. They had posted the score that Jesus was ahead, turning Jesus and John into rivals in the eyes of the people. So Jesus left the Judean countryside and went back to Galilee. To get there, he had to pass through Samaria. He came into Sychar, a Samaritan village that bordered the field Jacob had given his son Joseph. Jacob's well was still there. Jesus, worn out by the trip, sat down at the well. It was noon. A woman, a Samaritan, came to draw water.
Would you give me a drink of water?
His disciples had gone into the village to buy food for lunch.
How come you, a Jew, are asking me, a Samaritan, for a drink?
Jews in those days wouldn't be caught dead talking to Samaritans.
If you knew the generosity of God and who I am, you'd be asking me for a drink, and I wouldn't give you fresh living water.
Sir, you don't even have a bucket to draw with, and this well is deep. So how are you going to get this living water? Are you a better man than our ancestor Jacob, who dug this well and drank from it, he and his sons and livestock, and passed it down to us?
Everyone who drinks this water will get thirsty again and again. Anyone who drinks the water I give will never thirst, not ever. The water I give will be an artesian spring within, gushing fountains of endless life.
Sir, give me this water so I won't ever get thirsty, won't ever have to come back to this well again.
Go call your husband and then come back.
I have no husband.
That's nicely put. I have no husband. You've had 5 husbands, and the man you're living with now isn't even your husband. Spoke the truth there, sure enough.
Oh, so you're a prophet? Well, tell me this. Our ancestors worshiped God at this mountain, but you Jews insist that Jerusalem is the only place for worship, right?
Believe me, woman. The time is coming when you Samaritans will worship the Father neither here at this mountain nor there in Jerusalem. You worship guessing in the dark. We Jews worship in the clear light of day. God's way of salvation is made available through the Jews. But the time is coming. It has. In fact, come when what you're called will not matter, and where you go to worship will not matter. It's who you are and the way you live that count before God. Your worship must engage your spirit in the pursuit of truth. That's the kind of people the Father is out looking for. Those who are simply and honestly themselves before him in their worship. God is sheer being itself, spirit. Those who worship him must do it out of their very being, their spirits, their true selves, in adoration.
I don't know about that. I do know that the Messiah is coming. When he arrives, we'll get the whole story.
I am he. You don't have to wait any longer or look any further.
Just then, his disciples came back. They were shocked. They couldn't believe he was talking with that kind of a woman. No one said what they were thinking, but their faces showed it. The woman took the hint and left. In her confusion, she left her pot of water. Back in the village, she told the people,
"Come, see a man who knew all about the things I did, who knows me inside and out. Do you think this could be the Messiah?"
And so they all went out to see it for themselves. In the meantime, the disciples pressed Jesus.
"Rabbi, eat. Aren't you going to eat?"
"I have food to eat you know nothing about."
"Who could have brought him food?"
"The food that keeps me going is that I do the will of the one who sent me, finishing the work he started. As you look around right now, wouldn't you say that in about 4 months it will be time to harvest? Well, I'm telling you to open your eyes and take a good look at what's right in front of you. The Samaritans' fields are ripe. It's harvest time. The harvester isn't waiting. He's taking his pay, gathering in the grain that's ripe for eternal life. Now the sower is arm in arm with the harvester. Triumphs. That's the truth of the saying, this one sow, that one harvests. I sent you to harvest a field you never worked. Without lifting a finger, you have walked in on a field worked long and hard by others."
Many of the Samaritans from that village committed themselves to him because of the woman's witness when she said, "He knew all about the things I did. He knows me inside and out." The Samaritans asked Jesus to stay on, so he stayed 2 days. A lot more people entrusted their lives to him when they heard what he had to say. They said to the woman, "We are no longer taking this on your say-so. We've heard it for ourselves and know it for sure. He is the Savior of the world."
This is the witness of the early church.
Thanks be to God.
Please pray with me. May the preached word draw us deeper into the written word and kindle in us the matchless love of the incarnate word. Amen. Good morning, and thank you so much for inviting us to be here with you today. We have an urgent task to be working together across all boundaries to preserve God's astoundingly beautiful creation. In fact, it has become more urgent as the world approaches certain atmospheric and natural thresholds. In some cases, these thresholds have already been passed. We know that we need to work together across many lines to address the reality facing us, that the continuity of God's creation is not assured. Today, we will look at an encounter early in Jesus' ministry that models for us how we can reach across boundaries and come to a greater self-understanding and to a greater shared understanding with people outside our immediate circles. This work of self and mutual understanding is an essential step to the urgent work of preserving creation. We have just heard the story of Jesus and the Samaritan woman at Jacob's well, as beautifully told and read by the McLean family. John chapter 4 follows the early part of Jesus' ministry after his baptism. Now, by this point in time, many people are being baptized by Jesus, John, and the other disciples throughout the Judean countryside. The Pharisees, meanwhile, were beginning to get politically antsy as they heard about all this activity, which seemed potentially subversive. So Jesus decided it was time to leave Judea with his disciples and head back to Galilee, his home province. Now, verse 4 says, but he had to go through Samaria. Now, just picture for a moment the map of the three regions of Palestine: Galilee in the north, Samaria in the center, and Judea in the south. Judea is where Jerusalem and the temple are located. Samaria is a non-Jewish region. The Mediterranean Sea is to the west, and the Jordan River is to the east. And it runs between the Sea of Galilee in the north and the Dead Sea in the south. The origin of these regional separations goes back 10 centuries before the time of Jesus. For over 1,000 years, language, culture, economics, and religious differences in the three regions became embedded in the lives of the people. The Galileans in the north were well off because they had good agriculture and fishing in the region. This made their southern neighbors somewhat envious. The Judeans, meanwhile, saw themselves as more culturally and religiously sophisticated than the rural Galileans and accused them of being lax in their observance of proper ritual. Also, the Aramaic dialects of the Galileans made them the butt of Judean humor. As for Samaria in the middle, it was part of the northern kingdom of Israel that rebelled against the Assyrians in 722 before the Common Era. Assyrian rulers exiled most of the Samaritans and in their place resettled Babylonians and Medians on their land. And then over succeeding generations, the remaining Samaritans developed distinct religious ideas, keeping a belief in Yahweh and in the law of Moses, but rejecting the rest of the Old Testament. Samaritans in Jesus' time, and actually to this day, refused to recognize Jerusalem as the center of worship. So the Samaritans built a temple on the slopes of Mount Gerizim in the 4th century before the time of Christ. Even though it was destroyed by a Jewish king, the Samaritans maintained that Mount Gerizim was the proper place to worship, while the Jews insisted on worshiping in Jerusalem. So, as Jesus sets out for Galilee, he takes the central road. It's the fastest and most direct route. although it required traveling through Samaria. He reached the Samaritan town of Sychar halfway through his 5 to 6 day walk home. He was tired out and thirsty, and he sat by Jacob's well around noon, the hottest time of the day. Not only was a village or city well a place from which to draw water, it was also a place to socialize, and in some cases, to find a marriage partner. Jesus' disciples, meanwhile, had gone into the city to buy food. A woman appears and asks Jesus for a drink of water, and so begins a conversation. The woman, and I wish we knew her name, wonders out loud why he would go against the social rules to ask for a drink. Strictly observant Jewish men would not have initiated a conversation with a Samaritan woman, nor taken a drink from a Samaritan water container. But we know that Jesus had close woman friends, and these friendships entailed many conversations. Also, besides Pilate asking Jesus if he is the king of the Jews, this is toward the end of Jesus' life, of course, it may be that the Samaritan woman is the only other person who talks to Jesus specifically about his Jewishness. Jesus responds with spiritual language and metaphor when he speaks of the living water he offers. But when he notices that this language doesn't resonate with her, he engages her on a very personal level, the subject of her marital status. "Go, call your husband and come back." "I have no husband." "You're right when you say you have no husband. You have had 5 husbands, and the man you have now is not your husband." "Sir, I can see that you are a prophet." So by now we can sense an emotional shift between Jesus and the Samaritan woman. She is feeling heard and understood, no longer feeling ostracized and alone. She desires the living water, the wisdom that Jesus has to offer. However, they continue their conversation, this time focusing on historical and religious differences about their places of worship: Jerusalem for Jews and Mount Gerizim for Samaritans. Soon the disciples return from the city market and question Jesus for speaking with a Samaritan woman. She, meanwhile, leaves her water jar and goes back to the city to witness to a prophet who told her everything she had ever done, looking for affirmation from others that he may be the Messiah. The outcome of the conversation between Jesus and the Samaritan woman is that many Samaritans from that city believed in him because of the woman's testimony, which was, "He told me everything I had ever done." The people of that day or of that place then invited Jesus to stay with them, which he did for 2 full days. Now, these 2 days when Jesus experienced Samaritan hospitality and engaged with them in his mission, they reflect the times in our personal, family, and communal lives and histories that animate and give us energy and lift us up. They can be times of turning, maybe of taking a path that offers life in a different way for us. It's not coincidental that for many years, Indigenous Anglicans have said to Anglicans such as myself, "Come and see." That is, come and see where and how we live. Come and drink with us and eat with us. Go out on the land with us. It's hard to remain disengaged after you have stayed in someone's home. We now turn to how this story in John's Gospel reveals for us some basic principles for Christian ecumenical dialogue, and I would offer, also for interfaith dialogue and witness. The first might be that Jesus recognized the affinity or bonds between Jews and Samaritans. They share a history, a region, and religious roots. In the work of ecumenical and interfaith dialogue, we too are called to deepen our understanding between Presbyterians and Anglicans, between Christians, Jews, Hindus, Muslims, and people of other faiths or of no professed faith. This knowledge provides a basis for conversation and respect for each other. Otherwise, how can we know what we hold most dear in our worship and in our communal lives? These are things we can and must learn from each other. I began to imagine myself in conversation with Jesus at a local coffee shop, maybe post-COVID. Would I be able to converse with him about the peoples and the history of the land along the Grand River? Would I be able to say, and would Jesus already concur, that the original peoples, the neutral Anishinaabe and Haudenosaunee peoples, were the original caretakers of this land, and that this land was invaded and settled by Europeans who ignored the treaties in general, and in our case, the Haldimand Proclamation of 1784. If Jesus spoke to me about the deep meaning of my history and place on this land, would I get it? As the exchange continued, Jesus and the woman both acknowledged and respected their respected the uniqueness of their differences. Both brought individual self-understanding to the conversation, and in turn understood and discovered that it brought about a new and deeper understanding of themselves and of each other. When it comes to interfaith and intercultural relations in our region, I listened to Laurier Professor Hind Albedle speak publicly of care for creation from an Islamic perspective, and my heart warmed. When I saw that Sri Ramdam Hindu Temple and Temple Shalom each raised a faith climate justice banner on their land, I rejoiced. And when Anishinaabe knowledge keeper Clarence Kachiji taught us on the land as we planted trees and bushes together at the edge of a field and forest, I sensed God in the midst of us. We all care for creation. We all acknowledge the love of the divine, of God, for the whole inhabited earth. And when we get together to share our stories, we bring self-understanding to the table and leave with a deeper understanding of others and of ourselves. Now, the conversation of Jesus and the Samaritan woman also points to the character of God, a God whose love for all people is unconditional and who offers a wide tent as an antidote to some of the religious separations we create that can be self-serving and limiting. When we hear John 3:16, "For God so loved the world, the people, the non-human world, the four-legged, the winged ones, the ones with fins, the entire cosmos, that he gave his only beloved son," then disengaging from the vital work of preserving creation is not an option. And this is the work of all of us. As Jesus says to the woman, "Everyone who drinks of this water, the water from Jacob's well, will be thirsty again. But those who drink of the water that I will give them will never be thirsty. The water that I will give will become in them a spring of water gushing up to eternal life." Their conversation also speaks to the trust we can have in Christ to make us whole and help us to transcend those barriers that keep us apart. As the Apostle Paul writes to the Ephesians, "For he himself is our peace, who has made the two groups one, that is, Jews and Gentiles, and has destroyed the barrier, the dividing wall of hostility." In recent years, faith communities are learning that solutions to the climate crisis depend on the recognition of the rights and spiritualities of Indigenous peoples, the original caretakers of the land and waters. Colonizing societies extract resources for mass consumption, but people of the land respectfully and sustainably harvest food for life. It is an economy of enough. Indigenous people practiced a jubilee ethos even before our Hebrew ancestors in the faith. Conserving and redistributing and practicing Sabbath economics of rest and renewal. This became clearer to me when I served as a note taker at the Indigenous Sacred Circle in their ongoing work as a self-determining church within the Anglican Church of Canada in November. What a gift to be invited to Indigenous-led gatherings and events where we can listen and learn, observe and participate in activities that are foundational for relationship building. May we too be people of the land and waters and renew our commitment to be Jubilee people. Religious leaders who gathered in Glasgow for COP26 in December expressed this connection of God, people, and land in a document called Making Peace with Nature, Heeding the Call of Indigenous Peoples. Just as the Indigenous Palestinian, Jesus, and the Samaritan woman had to engage in some negotiation around their differences, so too do faith communities need to bear witness with our elected leaders. Elected leaders in Canada have the power to draft and pass legislation for the commons, all those valuable things that enable the flourishing of life in community, clean air and water, access to adequate shelter, access to education, equitable employment, and so on. Whether faith animates the commitments of elected leaders or not, we respect the office they hold to serve all people and their duty to protect the commons. Faith communities, for their part, need to build capacity to do our own homework, to speak knowledgeably with elected leaders, and express our commitment to the protection and fair distribution of those valuable social goods just mentioned. Faith Climate Justice organized delegations and prepared statements last spring, urging our local leaders to increase their climate targets to 50% reductions of greenhouse gas emissions by 2030. We presented again to Regional Council in December as our elected representatives received public input on their 2022 budgets. There is much to learn from Jesus' encounter with the Samaritan woman at the well. So let us labor, and let us recognize that we reap that for which we did not labor. We are not beginning from scratch. The Spirit is already at work in the world among all people. Our task is to take up that work where we are located in this moment. And the reward? So that the sower and reaper may rejoice together, as it says in verse 36, and that all people can meet their needs, that the land, air, and waters are replenished and not depleted, and that God's love is known throughout the earth. May it be so.
Channel to a life made new. Peace be with you. It's so good for us to be together today. I am feeling lots of gratitude today, MC, for the gift of music. Courtney, as always, for working in partnership with you in ministry. To the tech crew at the back today, we have Deb and Kathleen and Grant. Thank you to you. Thank you to you, Henriette. Thank you for being here today, for sharing your gifts, for helping us. You helped me think about that text in a new way today, and I'm grateful to you for that. It was a message for me of unity, community, hope, and thank you. Thank you for that gift. I'm looking forward to talking with you more about your sermon today and about how that connects and is a part of what Faith, your organization, FCJ, does. Thank you so much for the gift. And to Becky as well, for her gifts today. Thank you, Becky, for spending some time with the young at heart today. We are grateful to you. Complete list of announcements goes out every Thursday in the This Week at Knox newsletter, emailing. If you don't get that email, let us know. We can add you to the list. Just a couple of things that I'd like to bring to your attention today, though. One is that the building is still closed. The COVID health and safety team is meeting tomorrow to discuss what's happening next and if anything is happening next. We will keep you up to date on decisions that are made. There's going to be a conversation that's happening with the youth and young people of our congregation. In the fall, we had a number of groups gather to talk about the future of our congregation, what our priorities are, and we're having a special gathering of the junior and senior high youth from Church School and Logos, and that's going to be happening next Sunday at 11:30 on Zoom. If you are a youth and listening in and want to be part of that, you can get in touch with Courtney if you'd like more information. If you're a parent and have a youth, then let them know that this is going on. We need to hear, we want to hear from our youth. And just a reminder of a young adult online gathering happening a week from Monday at 7:30. Contact Courtney if you'd like more information on that. Friends, your gifts make a difference to the lives of so many people connected with Knox Waterloo. Thank you, thank you, thank you for your gifts, for supporting Christ's ministry in and through this community of faith. I know this is the season of paying off credit card from Christmas, but whatever gift you're able to give to the ministry of Christ through Knox is a beautiful gift. Thank you.
Like a healing stream in a barren desert, spirit water bringing life to dusty earth. God is trickling through our lives as in a dream unfolding, promising revival and rebirth. Like a healing stream, like a gentle rain on a thirsty garden, spirit water come to nourish tiny seeds. coax a new creation, yearning for an end to want and need, like a gentle rain. Like a river strong with a restless current, spirit water rushing on to distant shore, God is carving out a channel in a new direction, calling for an end to hate and war, like a river for horizons, spirit water with a love both deep and wide, God is working in our hearts to shape a new tomorrow, God will always challenge and provide, like a mighty sea, like a river strong, like a gentle rain, like a healing stream.
Prayers of gratitude and prayers of hope. Henriette, know that we will carry Faith Climate Justice as an organization in our hearts, and know that our prayers will hopefully materialize more than just a feeling and into deeper partnership and action and hope with you. So thank you. We continue with prayers. Mother God, in you we find birth and rebirth. We are filled with gratitude that you spoke into the silence, sharing light in places of shadow. You spoke, blowing clean, life-giving air into space, warmth and cold, breeze and spirit. You spoke, solid ground and gushing water, gentle water. People, plants, animals, an ecosystem filled with abundance and sustainability. And you gave us, human beings, stewardship over all that you had made, inviting us to care for it and for all beings, human and non-human, trees, plants, creatures, air. May our care be more than heartfelt. May it move from heart to hands, from sentiment to action, from isolation to community, and sometimes from speaking to listening. May we work to limit pollution and help clean the air we breathe, clean the poisons from the ground, reforest desolate land. God, may we live in right relationship, in partnership, in a spirit of unity with the earth as a whole, with all of the earth's creatures and plants, minerals, elements, molecules. We are all one. Mother God, in you we find birth, and in you we find rebirth. Be born in us again, we pray. Create something new through us, we pray. For you speak, you create. Help us to relearn, we pray, how to care for all. How to be the hands and feet of Christ in your good world. These prayers, both spoken and unspoken, we offer in the spirit of the risen Christ. And together God's people say, Amen. Our closing hymn for the morning is hymn number 301. Like a rock, God is under our feet. Like a roof, God is over our heads. Like the horizon, God is beyond us. Like water in a pitcher, God is in us and in the pouring out of us. And like a pebble in the sea, we are in God. And as God has come to you and touched your life in even a small way today, may you be inspired to share that and touch the life of the world. Amen. I'm Hugh Donnelly, one of the ministers at Knox Waterloo. Thank you for being a part of the worshiping community today. You can find us online at knoxwaterloo.ca, and you are always welcome to call us at 519-886-4150. This broadcast is made possible by you, listeners and friends of Knox, who support Knox's broadcast ministry. Please consider making a donation in gratitude as you are able,
and may the peace of Christ be with you.